Once again, Happy New Year to everyone. More blessings this year. Progress this year. More forward journey this year in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this moment. We thank you because this year you have promised us there's going to be more. And Lord, we pray you clear the way in the path of everyone in Jesus' name. And we pray that every chain that binds, every cord that holds down, everything that gives us setback, you cut away from every life in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, that your strength and your might will be a reality in every life in Jesus' name. Victory all the way. Dominion all the way. Power and strength all the way. And courage to achieve all the way. And your spiritual power will be very definite in every life. That your people will be stronger and stronger. And Lord, we pray there'll be more in every life. In Jesus' name we pray. Church, another amen. God bless you. We're looking at 2 Samuel chapter 23. And I'm reading from verse 10. And you'll note a word there. And he arose. And he smote the Philistines until his hand was weary. And his hand clave to the sword. And the Lord gave him a great, what's your word? Victory that day. And the people returned after him only to spoil. Underline that word for you this year, victory. Amen. Look at verse 12. And he stood in the midst of the ground and defended it and slew the Philistines. And the Lord wrought, tell me, a great victory. Psalm 98, we're looking at verse 1. In Psalm 98, reading from verse 1, it tells us, "Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song." You'll not sing an old song. Sometimes in the valley, sometimes on the mountain, old song will come out, will cut off from your mouth. And then, "I never got it, I never make it." Everybody gets, "I never get." Old song, you'll not have it in Jesus' name. A new song. A song of joy. A song of victory. A song of assurance. It says, "Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. And for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm has gotten him the victory." Victory sure in Jesus' name. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 25. And we're reading from verse 8. Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8. "He will swallow up death in victory. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces." Why don't we make that personal? "And he will swallow up death in victory. And the Lord God will wipe away from my face in Jesus' name." You'll cry no more. "And the rebuke of his people shall he take away from off all the earth. For the Lord has spoken it." 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And we're reading from verse 57. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57. "But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." On the first day of the month, or the first month of this year, possess this one. Amen. "But thanks be to God, which giveth me." Are you here, my people? "We giveth me the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." You'll have it. Amen. Your family will have it. Our local church will have it. All our churches will have it. Our time of victory has come. In 1 John chapter 5, reading from verse 4. 1 John chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 4. And whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. It was so appropriate this morning we learned about David. And that David expands his kingdom. And that David got the victory. And as we have read through those Old Testament verses and the New Testament verses, we have seen that victory belongs to the people that trust in God, the people that have faith in God, and the people that depend and trust in God every moment of the day and every day of the year. And as long as David trusted in the Lord, he had the victory. To the extent we also trust in the Lord, to that extent we have and we enjoy the victory, total victory. Victory over sin, victory over enemies, victory over sickness, victory over evil powers, victory over evil personalities, victory over Satan and all his messengers. Total victory, total deliverance, true liberation, triumphant dominion, lifetime victory. Do you know you can have victory every day of this year, every week of this year, every month of this year? What a wonderful thing to start the day and to start the year with the note and the understanding and the confidence and the faith of victory. Everything that minimizes or decreases or diminishes victory in your life will be wiped out from this beginning of the year in Jesus' name. But you know, we must put on the whole armor of God. The enemy works overtime during this period of festivities. You know, people don't understand this time crossing over from the last year, from the old year to the new year. They let go of themselves, and they let go of themselves to the devil. And then these men and women and young people, they put their weapon aside and watchfulness aside, and they do not know that they walk fear, and it kills many of them at this time of merriment. But thank God you are alive. Not only alive, you are strong. Not only that you are strong, you have resurrection power walking inside you. And I can see you as you look at your front and you see that January is before you, February before you, until December before you. I see victory all the way, power all the way, dominion all the way, and you'll have it in Jesus' name. We're looking at the scriptures today on the believer's total victory throughout his lifetime. The believer's total victory throughout his lifetime. There are three things we need to understand. Number one is that we need a weapon. Number two, we need watchfulness. Number three, we need to know and remember when you walk fear. Number one, the weapon. Number two, a watchfulness. Number three, the warfare. Number one, the weapon of salvation. If we're going to overcome, if we're going to have the victory over everything that comes across our way, already celebrate and rejoice with you, because I know you have the victory. And we need to understand the weapon of salvation. Number one, the weapon of salvation from all sins. The weapon of salvation from all sins. Number two, our watchfulness over the supremacy of self. Our watchfulness over the supremacy of self. Now many people don't understand how the enemy works. If the enemy cannot get you from outside, he tries to get you from within. He looks at somebody that, you know, is right there, always with you, and then he walks through that individual. And there is something that's always with you. You cannot separate yourself from this with you. The self, yourself, yourself, internally there. And the devil can walk with self, but you'll bring everything down this year in Jesus' name. Our watchfulness over the supremacy of self. Number three, our warfare against the strongholds of Satan. We have won the battle. you will win the day. I want you to understand, and you can locate and identify where that enemy is, you will overcome and you will conquer. But you need to understand, that that weapon you have, and that security you have, and that faith you have must be intact. And as we go through this, this year we're not just preaching. This year, God is going to transform your life through the word in Jesus' name. Our warfare against the strongholds of Satan. We're looking at number one. Number one, the weapon of salvation from all sins. There are many people that read about David, and they see that David overcame. And they say, you see that David, he overcame. As he overcame, I am going to overcome. Of course, yes, you cannot overcome. But what was it in his life? The foundation of that victory. What was it in David's life that made him to have that weapon that gave him the victory? Look at 2 Samuel chapter 22. I'm reading from verse 3. 2 Samuel chapter 22. And we're reading from verse 3. The God of my rock, in him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my savior. Thou savest me from violence. You can tell in his life, he had salvation. He had salvation. That's why later he prayed when something went wrong. That's why later he reminded the Lord when something was not really properly right. He said, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. If there was anything that made that man to have the victory, it's because of the foundation of salvation, that faith in salvation, that fruit of salvation, that fortress around him that salvation built in his life. Salvation, the weapon of salvation. Look at it from verse 1. And David spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord delivered him out of the hand of all his enemies. Looks like you are ready for deliverance from all your enemies. Think about what your life will be. Think about what progress you will make when on the side, all the enemies are down. On the left, all the enemies are defeated. On the every before you and behind you, all the enemies are lying on the ground. And you are standing tall. Somebody there. I said you are standing tall. Somebody there. I said you are standing tall. And then all the things that used to pull you, all the things that tried to drag you, all the things that used to discourage you, all the things that made you to feel, I can't walk today, I can't do anything today, everything is gone. Yeah. Brother champion, yeah. Sister champion, you will conquer in Jesus' name. And look at verse 2. And he said, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, the God of my rock, in him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my savior. Thou savest me from violence. All the violence in your community, the Lord will protect you. And it will save you in Jesus' name. We're looking at Psalm 140. We're reading from verses 7 and 8. Psalm 140. We're looking at 7 and 8. It says, O God, the Lord, the strength of my salvation. You see, David is always telling us. It says, you think I'm strong because of salvation? You think I am steady? It's because of salvation. You think I'm fortified? It's because of salvation. And you think I'm an overcomer? It's because of salvation. Oh God, the Lord, the strength of my salvation. And thou hast covered my head in the day of battle. Ah, look at that. Thou hast covered my head in the day of battle. If the devil could have his way, if the enemies could have their way, if the Philistines could have their way, they want to throw something at the head of David. But he said, because of salvation, what a shield. Because of that freedom from sin, what a shield. And because of my trust and confidence in the Lord, what a shield. He said, you are protected and you have covered my head in the day of battle. Grant not, O Lord, the desires of the wicked, for that not is wicked device, lest they exalt themselves. And this same salvation the Lord has come to give you, and the Lord has given you already, and the Lord has provided that for you. And when you make use of that, like David, you are going to be a conqueror. I said you are going to be a conqueror. Because you see, the sinner has no strength. The sinner has no power. The sinner has no security. The sinner has no promise of victory. The sinner has no real hope. The sinner has no protection from any kind of evil and from the evil one. But salvation is a mighty weapon for the child of God. He has repented of all his sins. He has believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, the only Savior, and he has received salvation. And because he has salvation, that real child of God has victory over sin. Because he's saved, he has partnership with Christ. And because of that, he has the promise of dominion. And I'm telling you, this year you have the promise of dominion. Don't let anything tell you that the enemy is stronger than you are. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Because you are saved, you are a child of God. He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, and I will come in. And then he says, I'll sup with him, I'll fellowship with him. He's in fellowship with you. And that power of the Lord will never fail in your life in Jesus' name. That's what a child of God has that a sinner does not have: the promise of dominion, the power of sonship, the protection of the shepherd, the provision of a sufficiency, the provision of a sufficiency. Because you have salvation, you'll find your strength will be sufficient for the day. And as your days are, so will your strength be. Whatever challenge will come your way, as you are thinking, how will I do this? How will I overcome this? Lo and behold, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is sufficient for you. My power is sufficient for you. You'll find him sufficient in your life in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21. Here the angel tells us about what Jesus Christ will bring. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name. Shout it out. Jesus. If it's your Savior, shout that name. Jesus. If you have confidence, shout that name. Jesus. If you know that that name can never fail, the name that overcomes sin, the name that overcomes sickness, and the name that thrashes and crushes every power of Satan from your way and from your life, shout that name. Jesus. When you mention that name, hell will tremble. When you mention that name, heaven will stand at attention. When you mention that name, all the promises of God will be yes and amen in your life. You mention that name and you are standing on the platform of salvation. You are standing on the foundation of the faith of salvation. You cannot fail. You cannot fail. When you are alone, mention that name. In the night, mention that name. In the day, mention that name. You will never fail in Jesus' name. She shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Thank God I'm saved. Somebody there, thank God I'm saved. Somebody there, tell me, thank God I'm saved. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4 and verse 12. Acts chapter 4 verse 12, it says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. What a privilege you have, you know that name. What a privilege you have that name. What a privilege you have the salvation provided by that name. And because David was saved, salvation gave him the victory. He'll give you the victory. You'll have the success. You'll have the progress. You'll have the achievement. Block failure away from your mind. Are you not saved? Are you not born again? If he has conquered the greatest of all enemies, which is sin, all the other less unimportant enemies, he'll get rid of them out of your life. He'll wipe your tears away. He'll change your life and turn your life around. Because you have salvation in Christ, you have everything. Look at Romans chapter 8 and verse 32. Romans chapter 8 verse 32. Look at this. It says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. Listen to this. How shall he not with him also freely give us? How many things are you going to have this year? All those things you've been dreaming about and thinking about and praying about, all things, this year is the year of possession. This year is the year of victory. And this year is the year of joy. Block failure out of your mind. Defeat out of your mind. Sorrow out of your mind. A new day has come. A new year has come. When last did the year start? With the Lord's Day. What a wonderful year this is. The wonder of God will never cease your life in Jesus' name. Point number two now, our watchfulness over the supremacy of self. Our watchfulness over the supremacy of self. I need to tell you something here. Whatever we say, understand, please. David is in heaven. And we thank God for that. And where he is gone, and where the Son of David, Jesus Christ, has gone, there we're going, you will get there in Jesus' name. But you know, all these things are written for our learning. All the things that, you know, there are some people, they get to where they're going. Think about a person going from our city here, and he's going to another city. And on the way, there's a minor accident. And then they repair the vehicle, and he gets in there. And then on the way again, there's another collision. And then, thank God, his life was spared. And then they repair the vehicle. And then he goes on, and he has stops on the way, challenges on the way, hunger on the way, and or avoidable accidents on the way. And eventually, he got there. Now we're not making fun of anybody. We're not making fun of the people that have any kind of challenge on the way. The joy is that they've got to their destination. The joy is that David has got to heaven. And now we are on the way. What we're saying now is we can avoid all the unnecessary tears in the way. We can avoid all the unnecessary mishaps in the way. All the accidents that man got on the way. And the Lord raised him up. And the Lord repaired his life. And the Lord repaired his vehicle. And then he still got to destination. We can avoid that. That's why we're talking about this point number two now. Our watchfulness over the supremacy of self. You see, David, he conquered the Philistines, he conquered this city and that city, but there was something that he didn't understand, he must also conquer. We're looking at Proverbs chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 32. Proverbs 16, verse 32. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his own spirit than he that taketh a city. You compare both. It says, you know, there are enemies there in that city. And they say, you will not get here. David, you will not get here. And he stood right there. And David went courageously, captured that city. And then he got it. But, you know, there was a self inside. His own spirit inside. And his own nature inside. He didn't know that it is better, it is higher, it is greater to conquer the enemy within before you go out to conquer the city. The second part of that verse, he that ruleth his spirit is better, is greater than he that taketh a city. We're looking at Proverbs chapter 25, verse 28. Proverbs 25 and 28. We're looking at that verse 28. He that has no rule over his own spirit, he that has no authority over his own spirit, he that has no power over his own spirit, he that has no dominion over his own spirit, is like a city that is broken down without walls. You see, there is, it's one thing to conquer sin. It's one thing to conquer all the other things we call iniquity and transgression and wrongdoing. But now you come on the inside, the supremacy of self. Thank God we will win the victory. If my people are there, they will say a good amen. Second Samuel chapter 11. In 2 Samuel chapter 11, we're looking at verse 2. 2 Samuel chapter 11, we're looking at verse 2. And it came to pass in an evening tide that David arose from off his bed, and he walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself. And the woman was very beautiful to look upon. Now he ordered the other people went to battle. And this David now saw a woman, you know the name. But look at the last verse in verse 27. And the last part of that verse. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. And then you come to chapter 12. In chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 9. In chapter 12, verse 9, wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight, that thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from thine house, because, and then the message went on. You know what? All that David got and gained by overcoming sin, having salvation, everything he lost to the supremacy of self. That self within, his spirit within, he couldn't conquer that. He couldn't overcome that. And outwardly, all over those cities and all those enemy nations, he conquered all those Philistines. But now, the one within, flesh, self. Actually, many times you read about flesh in the New Testament. Flesh, the works of the flesh are these. What does that mean? Many people are thinking about their flesh and muscles and bones. As you look at that flesh, I want you to do some writing. Do you have paper there? Do you have pen there? So you will write flesh. Write flesh to start with. Normal F-L-E-S-H. Have you done that? Good class. And now you are going to start from the H, and then write H, then put a little dash, and then S, that's the next letter. What's the next letter? E, what's the next letter? What's the next letter? Now, when you look at H, self, how do you think of that? Himself, herself. That's the flesh there. The flesh is self-inverted. It's self-reversed. It said hiding under the spelling. But you see, the problem was that he had self. Let me explain that to you. David saw that Beersheba. And then, number one, he forgot God's glory. All he could remember was some pleasure. David saw that woman and he forgot Israel's victory, because Joab had gone to the battlefield and they were to conquer all those enemies. He forgot the victory. He forgot that when Joshua was on the battlefield and Moses was there lifting up the hand, because of the lifting on of the hand of the leader, Joshua was having the victory. He forgot Israel's victory because all he could remember was pleasure. And then he forgot Uriah's faithfulness. He didn't ever think about any other sin anymore, any other person anymore. All he could remember is, I will have it. He forgot Bathsheba's covenant of marriage. That woman had made covenant with the husband. I will be for you. I will be with you till death do us part. And David forgot that. He forgot also his own honor and example. He forgot his own position. And then he went after what he shouldn't have got. He forgot his future. He forgot the law of God. All he could remember now think of was self. Self conquered him. And then suffering came, and shame came, and suffering and sorrow followed, and then sickness came in. I pray you will conquer. Amen. Somebody there, you will conquer. Amen. Hey, look at Judges. You see, if you conquer sin, but you don't understand that self is still there, and you need to conquer self, you might get into trouble, but because you are hearing this, trouble will get away from you. We're looking at Joshua chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 21. Joshua chapter 7. We're looking at verse 21. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment and 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then I coveted. The self, I saw it, I couldn't remove my eyes from there. I saw that, I couldn't take my mind away from there. He said, I saw that, I coveted and took them, and behold, their heat in the earth, in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. He got into trouble, he lost his life, because what he saw, he couldn't take away his eyes from there. Judges, we're reading from chapter 14. Judges chapter 14, and we're reading from verse 2. Judges chapter 14, verse 2, and he came up and told his father and his mother, and said, I have seen a woman in Timnath of the daughters of the Philistines. Now therefore get her for me to wife. Then his father and his mother said unto him, is there never a woman among the daughters of the of thy brethren, or among all my people, that thou goest to take a wife of the uncircumcised Philistines? And Samson said unto his father, get her for me, for she pleaseth me well. You understand that self has taken control, and self was now on the seat of the throne, the supremacy and the finality of the power and the dominion of self, that he couldn't remove his mind away from that, that will take the victory away from him, that will take his honor away from him, that will take his dominion away from him. You will be free. I said, you will be free. You see, where the supremacy of self reigns without subjugation. Subjugation, because God has given us the power and the weapon to subdue. We're going to subdue, you know, but the enemy is not out, the enemy out there, that one we have conquered. We have conquered, and you will conquer in Jesus' name. But the one that will carry about, the one inside you, the one that will move about with, the one inside you, the one that will pull you down, the one inside you, the supremacy of self, you're going to have the victory in Jesus' name. You know, where there's no subjugation of self, what happens? Number one, self-absorption. Self-absorption. The fellow is obsessed with self, absorbed in self. All he can think about, all he can picture, all he can dream about is self. Satisfaction of self. Number two, self-bias. There are people that are biased towards themselves. They don't think about the good of Uriah. They don't think about the faithfulness of Uriah. They don't think about the covenant of Bathsheba. They don't think about the honor of the nation. All they are thinking about, they are biased towards themselves. What I want is the most important. What I get is the most important. My will is the most important. They are self-bias. Number three, self-complacency. Self-complacency. I defeated Goliath before. I defeated the Amalekites before. I defeated that one before. What am I doing? Let Joab go and do the rest. Who will say I've not done enough? Now I can rest. When you rest, when you should be standing up, when you should be walking, when you should be aggressive, when you should pull through and pull forth and do what you ought to do. Self-complacency. And then the self-delusion, the self-deception. It cannot happen to me. It may happen to other people. Other people may fall. Other people, self may take the better part of it. But me, I'm all right. Self-deception, self-delusion. There is self-exaltation. It is mine. David thought, well, I'm the highest among the people. I'm higher than Uriah. Who is Uriah? I can take his wife. Who is Joab? I can tell Joab that write a letter, and when this man gets you, this is what you do. Self was at work. The man did not have authority and dominion and power, subjugation, to subjugate the flesh. And I self-flattery. I am a nobody else. I'm the songwriter, nobody else. I write all those psalms and nobody else. I have confidence in God and nobody else. And God has a covenant with me and nobody else. Self-flattery, self-gratification. Self-gratification, all that David was looking for now, just to gratify self. You see, when self takes over and self is ruling and self is supreme, you will forget every other thing. But this year is not going to be a year of forgetfulness. You will not forget yourself. You will not forget your glory. You'll not forget your promotion. You'll not forget your future. You'll not forget heaven. But you know, he forgot, and all that remained was just self-gratification, self hardening, self-hardening. The people that harden themselves against whatever, well, nothing will happen. Nothing will happen. I know how to pray, I will pray. I know how to call upon God, I will call upon God. I know how to lay hold of the promises, I will lay hold on. And God is a good God anyway. And God will forgive, and God will set me free. And he hardened himself until he did what he did. Self-hardening, self-indulgence. The people, they cannot deny that self. They cannot say, self, come off out of that place. This new year, there's no self-indulgence. Self inside you wants you to say something wrong. You say, no, I will not say that. Tell me, I will not say that. It wants you to go to the wrong place, and you tell me, I will not go there. You are able to control that self. There's no self-indulgence in your life. There's self-justification. Self-justification. After all, who is it that will live a free life and will never commit any sin? And I've been living right and living right and living right. There's only one thing that, you know, I will do. Do you think that God will mind this one? Self-justification. And then there is self-kingmaker. Self-kingmaker. The people that put themselves above the law, they say, I'm the king, I'm the kingmaker. I make myself the king, and I have authority over that law. I have authority over those commandments. And those commandments will never catch me. The commandments are for them, and for them, and for them. But for me, it's a self-kingmaker. They're self-love, self-love. And they pitch themselves, they pamper themselves, you know. I need this, and I must have this. If I don't have this, I'll not be happy. I'll be miserable. I want that woman at all cost. How about a saucepan? Forget about a saucepan. I say I have the need. I love her, and I want to do something with her. Self-love. You see, if you don't crush that sin and wash up that sin from your life this year, the year that should be a year of victory will be a year of regret. It will not be so for you in Jesus' name. Have you heard of self-management? Self-management. Hey, David, Nathan is nearby. You could easily call Nathan. I'm going through some things in my life. I'm going through this turbulence, and my mind is saying, I should send my servants to go and call that man. But he said, Nathan, I don't want Nathan at this time. I don't want any prophet at this time. I don't want any counselor at this time. I don't want any challenge at this time. Self-management, self-nurture. The people, you know, they nurture nothing inside them. There is an unclean thing, they nurture it. There is temptation, they nurture temptation. And there is that pollution, you know, swimming around in their mind. They nurture that self-nurture. Self-opinionated. Self-opinionated. That means that it is my opinion. This is my idea. No counseling, please don't talk to me. And no advice, please don't advise me. And there's, I don't want any reading of the Bible. I know the Bible already. Self-opinionated. You see, the people that have that, and they have the supremacy of self, and self is in control. And self, they want dragging them, and driving them, and pushing them, and drawing them. They will sleep. I pray you will not sleep. Amen. Give me a good amen. Amen. And there's self-pity. Self-pity. That woman did that to me. I'm a clean man. I'm a holy man. I'm a righteous man. Everybody knows me. Am I not the one that rose? Who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? They that have clean hands and a pure heart, I know that. Were it not for that person that was in the wrong place and doing the wrong thing at the wrong time, I wouldn't have found self-pity. Instead of repenting immediately and coming to the Lord, self-qualification. I'm still qualified. I'm still... Who is going to be king? I'm the anointed one. Whatever I've done, wherever I am, whatever I'm doing, wherever I'm going, whatever it is, I'm still qualified. Self-qualification, self-righteousness. How many times have I done this? Only this once. How many times have I gone at only that once? Do you remember what I did when Saul was after me? I spared his life. Do you remember what I did when somebody told me that you killed a Saul? I took care of that. I'm righteous. Only this one single bought and single challenge in my life. Self-righteousness. And then there is self-seeking. Self-seeking. You know, self-seeking, you know, I must protect myself. I must protect my honor. Now that woman sent and gave information and said, David, I am pregnant. Okay, I know what to do. And then sent for the husband and said, how is the battle? How is the war? How is everything going on over there? Everything is going on this and that. Okay, go home and relax and enjoy yourself so that it can indirectly put the whole scene on the husband. But the man refused to go home. And then he said, are you not going to go home? Look at you, you are coming from the battle. And the fellow said, the ark of the Lord is on the field, and Joab, my master, is over there. Will I go home to refresh myself? And then he made him drunk. Think about that. Self-seeking, just to make sure that I protect myself. I cover this. Nobody will know this thing. And the man, even in the drunken situation, will not go back home. And then he said, if you will not go back home, but you know, he said, will soon come out. And then he wrote a letter to Joab and said, when this man gets to that place, get him to the heat of the battle and then retreat from him so that I can fall into the hands of the enemy. All that he did by self-seeking. There's something we call self-thought. Self-thought. And that's what Saul said. He said, I verily thought within myself. That's Acts chapter 26, verse 9. I verily thought within myself, I should do great things against the name of the Lord. And the people like that, self-upgrading, the people that upgrade themselves. Everybody knows they're now in the valley. Everybody knows he has fallen. Everybody knows he's now. He upgrades himself. And he calls bold face. And then who is going to challenge me? I am. And nobody else. Self-upgrading, self-valuation. Self-valuation. They put a high price on themselves. Angels think less of them. God thinks low of them. The kingdom thinks low of them. Believers who know the truth, they look down on them. They say, it doesn't matter. I know who I am. I know who I am. And then they claim promises that do not belong to them. Self-valuation. Nathan came and said, King David, I have a story. I saw something. Tell me. A man came in a journey to visit somebody. And then this fellow that they visited, instead of taking something from his own flock, he went to the flock of a lowly poor man who has nothing but that little ewe lamb, and he killed that. David said, what? Somebody did that in my kingdom here, he will die. Before he dies, he's going to pay four times. And then Nathan said, thou art the man. You know how to judge. You know how to evaluate other people. And you evaluate yourself high. But thou art the man. Self-valuation. Self-will. Self-will. I've done that. I've done one thing wrong. Killed the husband. Now, I must take the woman. I'm not going to just stop at one thing. Two things. I must go the whole length. Self-will. What was his conscience at that time? Self-excuse. Okay, self-excuse. After all, I put the woman in that position. And I've made the woman a widow. And with her being a widow now, what will I do? If I don't take care of the woman, so he married the woman. And the thing that David did was evil in the sight of the Lord. Self-yeast. You know what those bakers do? They take yeast and they put it in the flour and then swells up. And this man, and the people that have not conquered self, that self is the yeast in their lives. It broadens them. It enlarges them. It makes them swell up. And you think they are greater and higher and bigger than they really are. Self-yeast. Self-zealots. There was a political party that was called zealots at the time of the New Testament. And these people were zealous for Caesar, or they were zealous for this, or zealous for that. But this one, self-zealot, zealous for himself, for his own promotion. And what the Lord is telling us, that one self is there, and the wall is cracked, and you do not have the subjugation, and the destruction, and the defeat of self. Self will take over your life. Everything you do, you move here, you move there, you move there, you'll be carrying along self. Self will die. this year self will not have the supremacy. Self will not have dominion. That's why the Lord Jesus Christ told all the people that were following him, you want to follow Christ? Self must die. You must deny self. We're looking at Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 24. Matthew chapter 16, we're looking at verse 24. And then said Jesus to his disciples, if any man come after me, let him do what? Tell me out loud. Let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Deny himself. And there are people, they don't know they ever have to deny themselves. You know, something tells you on the inside, say this. There are times you deny yourself. That self, I deny you. I will not deny Christ, I deny you. And then there are times your eyes will see something and you'll say, take it, touch it, hold it, get it. That self talking to you. You must know when to deny self and say, no, I don't want to listen to your voice. I don't want you to control me. I've given myself to the Holy Ghost and to the Holy Scriptures, and my Savior rules my life. And therefore, I deny that voice that is telling me to do that. I'm looking at Mark chapter 8. In Mark chapter 8, we're reading from verse 34. Mark chapter 8. And we're reading from verse 34, denying self. It says, and when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, tell me out loud, say it again, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. You know, when you deny yourself like that, there might be a cross. The other fellow on the other side who wants you to, you know, yield into self, because it will aid him, because it will profit him, because it will give him pleasure. And then you deny yourself, that other fellow may have some things to grind with you. Take that cross and be courageous like a soldier of the Lord Jesus Christ. You'll be victorious in Jesus' name. I'm looking at Luke chapter 9 verse 23. Luke chapter 9 verse 23. Luke chapter 9 verse 23. And he said unto them all. And he said unto them, how many? And he said unto them, how many of them? And he says unto us, how many of us? All. And he said unto them all, if any man will come after me. Here it comes again. What did he say? Let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. We must deny that self. Deny that self. Self, I know you not. Self, I will not follow you. Self, I will not listen to you. I'm a man of my conviction, a man of courage, a man of confidence in the Lord. I will not do what self is saying. We're looking at Philippians chapter 2 verse 5. Philippians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 5. It says, Philippians 2, 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What kind of mind is that? Satan came and said, I'll give all these things to you if you fall down and worship me. Get there behind me, Satan. He'll not listen to that. And then when he was on the cross, the people were sneering and cheering, why don't you come down from the cross? I will believe you. He didn't listen to them. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not to be robbery to be equal with God, but he made himself of no reputation. And he took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You will win the victory. Somebody there said, you'll win the victory. Number one, victory over sin. Number two, victory over self. You know, as we think about David, he was a great man. Don't misunderstand me. He was a powerful man and a man of authority. Don't misunderstand me. Already he's in heaven. And we thank the Lord for his grace. But you know, there are many people that had that fall and he never rose up again. But thank God he fell and he rose. He stumbled and he rose. And now he's in heaven. But the point is this. We learn from the pitfalls. We learn from the mistakes. We learn from the tragedy that came upon him and his family. That's why number one, we're saying this year will be a year of victory. A year of dominion. A year of power. A year of authority. That every day we live a day at a time. We live an hour at a time. We live a minute at a time. That's not difficult. This minute. This minute. This moment. You will overcome. And then the next minute. And then the whole day. And then the next day. And then the whole week. And then the whole month. Who says you cannot have victory? I see victory in your life. I see power in your life. You'll have dominion in Jesus' name. Sickness will not conquer you. Evil spirits will not conquer you. Satan will not conquer you. The grace of God is sufficient for you. Number one, victory over sin through salvation. Number two, victory over self through sanctification. Number three now is victory over Satan. Our warfare against the strongholds of Satan. Our warfare against the strongholds of Satan. Look at 1 Chronicles chapter 21. 1 Chronicles chapter 21. I'm reading from verse 1. Here we cannot say too much about blaming David. But you know, all this have been written for us. We are now able to go to 2 Samuel, 1 Chronicles, and then go to the New Testament and know that even though we have won the victory over sin, we must still win the victory over self, and we'll still win the victory over Satan. If not, what we thought we gained by salvation from sin, we might lose. By the superiority of self, we might lose. By the strongholds of Satan. Point number three, our warfare against the strongholds of Satan. We're looking at 1 Chronicles chapter 21 verse 1. And Satan stood up against Israel and provoked David to number Israel. Think about that. Satan stood against the nation. Satan stood against his community. Satan stood against his family. Satan stood against his destiny and provoked David to number Israel. What was the result of that? Look at verse 11. So God came to David and said unto him, thus says the Lord, choose thee either 3 years famine or 3 months to be destroyed before thy foes than enemies, while that the sword of thine enemies overtaketh thee, or else 3 days the sword of the Lord, even the pestilence in the land, and the angel of the Lord destroying throughout all the coasts of Israel. Now therefore advise thyself what word I shall bring again to him that sent me. And David said unto Gad the prophet, I am in a great strait, in confusion. I'm at a crossroad. Let me fall now into the hand of the Lord, for very great are his mercies, but let me not fall into the hand of man. Look at verse 14. So the Lord sent, tell me out loud. You know, there are people that say everything that happens is coming from, either Satan or people of the world. They don't think about their lives. They don't examine their lives. They don't think about the provocation of Satan and how they yielded to Satan. And how God now is bringing the punishment and the pestilence upon them. So the Lord sent pestilence upon Israel, and there fell of Israel. Tell me the number. I want you to tell me that number. Use the preacher's voice and let everybody hear. Because of not taking heed to the strongholds of Satan. You know, all he had gone out to fight, because of the shield of salvation. And because of the confidence and the faith he had in salvation, he defeated many of the Philistines. But how many of them? But now, by yielding to self, if you read all the prophecies of Nathan, you'll see all the calamity and all the evil things he brought upon his family. And then, as he yielded to Satan, you'll find all the deaths and the destruction and the damnation he brought upon thousands and thousands of people in the land of Israel. Look at verse 15, and God sent an angel unto Jerusalem to destroy it. And as he was destroying, the Lord beheld and repented of the evil and said to the angel that destroyed, it's enough. Stay now thine hand. And the angel of the Lord stood by the threshold of Onan the Jebusite, and David lifted up his eyes and saw the angel of the Lord stand between the earth and the heaven, having a drawn sword in his hand, stretch out over Jerusalem. Then David and the elders of Israel who were clothed in sackcloth fell upon their faces. And David said unto the Lord, Is it not I that commanded the people to be numbered? Even I, it is, that have sinned and done evil indeed. Now you realize you have done evil, and this was bringing calamity upon the people. Why are we saying this? Because we need to learn. We must not be ignorant of the devices of Satan in particular. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 11. As you live your life this year, and as you go about this year, number one, you must conquer sin. If you're going to keep the victory, if you're going to keep the dominion, if you're going to keep the fulfillment of the promise of God in your life, you must have that shield of salvation from sin. Number two, you must conquer the supremacy of self. Self will try to raise its ugly head, and then there'll be all those branches of self trying to manifest in your life. But you know, you say, no, by the grace of God, I'm going to overcome. But when you have overcome sin, you have overcome self, that's not enough. The strongholds of Satan. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11. Lest Satan should take an advantage of us, for we're not ignorant of his devices. Lest Satan should take an advantage. If we close our eyes, I'm saved. I'm a child of God. There's victory before me, and there's dominion before me. Everything is all right. Then we become ignorant of the devices of Satan. I pray he will not bring you down. I said he will not bring you down. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And I'm reading here from verse 2. For I'm jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear lest by any means the serpent, the Satan there, that beguiled you through his subtlety, so your minds be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Look at verse 14. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. When he wants to destroy, that's what he does, but will cast down all his stronghold, will overcome all his power. This year will be a different year, a year of vigilance, and a year of victory, and a year of prayer, a year of fervency. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, I'm reading here from verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. You'll fight against the devil, and you will win. I said you will win. By the word of his promise, you'll win the victory. By the blood of the Lamb, you'll win the victory. By your vigilance, that you say, no, I overcome sin, I overcome self, I overcome Satan, you'll overcome in Jesus' name. For the weapon of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. In your life this year, the weapon is in your hand. You will bring into captivity everything to the obedience of Christ in Jesus' name. Pollution will not take over your life. Perversion will not take over your life. And all those defilements of sin will not take over your life. He will cleanse you by the blood of the Lamb. And then he will strengthen you by the energy of the Holy Ghost within you in Jesus' name. You will overcome. You must overcome. You have overcome. Overcomers there. I said overcomers there. Look at Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12. And we're reading from verse 11. Revelation chapter 12. Verse 11, and they overcame him, and they overcame him, personal, and we overcome him, personal, and I overcome him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. That's the tactics the devil uses. He has 13-year-old. If you don't do this, you'll die. If you don't do this, you'll die. If you don't go there, you'll die. If you don't do that, see, you'll die. They love not their lives unto the death. They say, Satan, he that is in me is greater than he that's in the world. Am I talking about somebody there? And because of that, we overcome. We overcome. Say it for yourself. I overcome. I overcome. From 1st of January to the 31st of December, you'll be a conqueror. You'll be a champion. You'll be a victor. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. I see them in front of me. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimonies. You wake up every morning. Victory is mine. Amen. You move on every day. Victory is mine. Amen. And you overcome everything and every challenge that the devil tries to throw your way. And by the grace of God, you go out with the promise of victory and you come back home in the evening with the performance of dominion. Amen. Let the victors rise up and tell the Lord they overcame. They overcame. I am going to overcome. Tell the Lord, I overcome. Tell the Lord, I overcome. Tell the Lord, I overcome. Why not? Overcome sin. Overcome self. Overcome Satan. Every day, for the whole year, and for your lifetime.